Sorry, listen, you guys probably thought it was teaching and I sighed. I've asked my friend, my coworker, the other side of the holster, Pastor's holster, Brother Mario to come and give a word. You know, whenever I ask Brother Mario to come and teach, he says yes. But you know what? When God calls him, he says yes.
That's right.
And so can we just give a great big clap offering as Brother Mario comes up?
Thank you, Pastor. God is good.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know what I love? I just, yeah. Yes, Ernie, I love you too. For the record, Brother Ernie, I love you, bro. What I love about reaching it, it's just a perfect example of it, was just displayed right now. And I shared this last Wednesday, if you heard the word that I had the opportunity to share, is the brotherly love.
Yeah.
It was an awesome display of brotherly love. And so I'm just going to assign this to you guys, is we need to resurrect that type of brotherly love in the church.
Yeah. Yeah.
So on Wednesdays, on Sundays, that's the type of greeting that should happen.
Come on.
And we've seen a glimpse of it on Sunday, and some of the brothers were talking. We're like, man, this feels good, this fellowship and this just... you know, blessing one another and laughing and hugging and just, you know, having a good time in the Lord. That's what it's about. That's brotherly kindness. And we need that. It's dying in the church and we need to resurrect that. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, so today I want to talk about the working of the Word of God in our lives. I want to talk about the working of the Word of God in our lives. So we're going to do some Bible reading. And let me just start this off on... And we can be honest with each other. We're all family here. How many struggle reading through the Word on a regular basis? Yeah. That's a common thing. That's a common thing. You ain't alone. You need to know that. But there's so much happens with the working of the Word of God in our lives. And that's what I asked the Lord to help me put together today, because I feel it's important. I feel like the Lord wants to do so many things, and we stifle the work of the Lord because we're not in the Word like we should. We're not in the Word. I say we, you know, the famous saying, not because I'm French or because I have a mouse in my pocket, because I struggle with that sometimes too. And you know what's made it harder is now I often rely on my digital Bible.
Yeah.
And it takes away because I'm really distracted. You know, a text will pop up, or a call will come in, or something will flash on my phone. And the enemy always makes sure that'll happen. But we need to get to the Word. That's so important. It's so vital. It's so essential for the believer that we need to do that. And so today I want to talk about the working of the Word of God in our lives. And we're going to start at John, Big John, the Gospel of John, chapter 1. And we're going to start at verse 1. Verse 1, while you guys go there, I'll take a drink of water. First John chapter 1, verse 1. All right. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him, nothing was made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was in the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Heavenly Father, I just thank you, Father Lord, for your word, my God. I thank you for the illumination of your word in the heart of every believer, Father Lord. Father, I thank you, Father Lord, that tonight, Father, you would just bring to light, Father, that you would open up spiritual eyes and ears, Father Lord, and our heart, Father Lord, to understand and know, Father Lord, the working that you want to do in our lives through your word, Father Lord. I love you. I trust you, Father, and I give you all the glory and honor right now, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I want to talk about the importance of the working of the Word of God in our lives. It is easy for us as believers to take for granted how God has brought us to this place that we call salvation and lose perspective of the power by which that came to be. We all came to the knowledge of Christ and salvation through the power and the working of the Word of God. Now, we may attribute our conversion or salvation to the preacher who led us to Christ, but it was the Word that shed light in a dark place that brought us to a place of repentance. It was the Word that shed light in a dark place that illuminated the power of the Word to salvation that was spoken into our life. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We keep reading. Chapter 1, verse 9. That was the light which give light to every man coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. And the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. He's talking about us. To those Amen. Who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And he was. Look at verse 16. And of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. You and I have received the fullness of Christ, all that fills up who Christ is, all that makes up who Christ is, his presence, his eternal life, his power, his grace, his mercy, and his love, and of his fullness we have all received. And grace for grace, this word says. Both graces hold the same meaning. It is grace, the goodwill of God towards us, and grace for the good work of God through us. And grace for grace. God's goodwill works the good work. And grace for grace. Our opening scripture describes Jesus Christ and all of this occurrence as happening through the Word. Through the Word. Are you with me? I don't want to make this difficult. I always want to make it simple. I want to make it relevant to us in our everyday life. So it's going to get simple right now. I just wanted that opening. We're talking about the working of the Word in our life as believers. We covered that simply to understand the degree of the Word that is working in our lives. It is that same degree of power and grace that God continues in our lives, the working of his Word. So how does the work of the Word, how does the work of the Word affect our lives? Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we're going to go to verse 16. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we're going to go to verse 16. We're going to understand some things about the Word tonight. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. It says this: all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. The NIV says it like this: all scripture is God-breathed. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So the first thing we need to understand is that if we're going to allow the Word to affect our life, we need to understand that all Scripture has its origin from within God himself. All of scripture.
Amen.
All of scripture originates from within God. All of it is God-breathed. That means that with the same authority and power that God spoke creation into existence is the same degree of power and authority that God spoke into his word. And that is the word that is working in the life of the believer. That same authority, the same authority that created earth, that created the mountains, that created light, the night, that created, that told the ocean to stop where it stopped. That same authority is the same authority that is in his written word.
Yeah,
it is God-breathed. It originated from God. He spoke all scripture into existence. And 2 Timothy tells us that the word of God teaches us. The working of the word in the believer doesn't just shed light to make us wise to salvation. It teaches us and makes us wise to all things in this life. It instructs us in that which is true as we go through life. The word does that, and we should look eagerly to the word of God as we move through this life. We should search the scriptures eagerly. There's something to say about somebody that goes to the word eagerly, looking for answers. This is where we should be going for our answers. This is where we should be going for truth. This is where we should be going for direction. This is where we should be going when we're lost. This is where we should be going, the believer. Because there's a working in the word of God in our life that it's not just for salvation, it's for all of life. So that we can be equipped for every good work. We're going to put it all together.
Amen.
We should be looking eagerly to the word of God. Give me an example of this as it came to be. Acts chapter 17, verse 10. Acts chapter 17, verse 10. Acts 17, verse 10. It reads, "Then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. When they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Therefore, many of them believed, and also not a few of the Greeks, prominent women as well as men." We need to learn to approach the word of God eagerly. We need to search the scriptures to find out for ourselves if what everyone is saying is so. We always hear about what the Lord is doing in somebody's life and how that came to be. We always look and we're memorized by the man of God who's preaching the word, or the praise and worship singer that's singing, or the one that's ministering, and you're just amazed by them. But we need to go to the scripture to see how that's so for ourselves.
Amen.
Okay.
The fact that the Bible says that it's profitable for teaching implies that it's necessary for us to study it. When you search the scriptures, you're searching the very nature and the very spirit of God himself. When you search the scriptures, you are searching the very nature of God. All of its origin is God, is from God. It's God-breathed. And when you do that, the word of God sanctifies and cleanses us as a believer for the purpose of presenting us to himself a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, holy and without blemish. That's in Ephesians chapter 5. 2 Timothy says also, what's next? That the word of God rebukes. The word of God rebukes. We don't like to hear that. We don't like to hear that. No, we don't know that. I don't like to be rebuked. I've been rebuked a couple of times. Luckily, I've been rebuked lovingly, the correct way.
Yeah.
So it's always had the right outcome. Here's the thing about this rebuke. It doesn't take the approach that the world takes when you tell somebody about themselves. When you have something on somebody and you're getting ready to lay into them. It doesn't have that approach. The rebuke of the word that happens to the word doesn't have that approach. That's what we liken it to, and that's why we don't like it. The reproof through the word is so that we can discover and we can get the light turned on to our condition. So that we can once again find our way to grace. Watch this. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. The reproof through the word is so that we discover or we get the light turned on to our condition. So that we can once again find our way to grace. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2. Hebrews. Hebrews 4:2. Actually, it is verse 12. Verse 12. Who said that?
4:12?
Yeah, was that you, Yvette?
Yeah.
Get down, that's what I'm talking about. How brother Al.
You said
420. 412. I apologize. She made his eyes. She was looking at my notes when I was sitting over there.
The word of God rebukes, brother.
420. If you read verse 2, it kind of goes along with what you're saying, but I don't want to trip you up.
Yeah.
Mark it for next week.
Hebrews verse 4, 12. Here we go. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of the soul and the spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need.
Hallelujah. Amen.
To find help in the time of need. Here's another thing about this as we study the word. As we study the word, we don't need anyone to rebuke us, because the word of God does that.
Yeah.
And the ability to come boldly before the throne of grace is not a process of shame. We begin to learn that it's a process of love. It's a process of God's love toward us. So as I read the word and it illuminates the condition of my heart from one day to the next, I'm led to the throne of grace, not in a process of shame, but in a process of love, where God shows me his grace, where God shows me his mercy, where God points me to where I need to get started again.
Amen.
The word of God rebukes. The word of God also corrects, 2 Timothy says. The word of God corrects. So we just spoke about how the word of God discovers our condition and leads us back to grace, but it doesn't stop there. The word of God corrects that which is amiss in our lives. And it's not hard for us as believers to get off track, to operate from one day to the next missing it. It's very simple to do. And the word of God corrects that which is amiss in our life. The word corrects the things that we have misunderstanding of in our lives and in our walk. The word of God will do that. The word restores us to the proper condition so that we can grow. As I've made it a point to understand and know the word, the Lord has corrected so much in my life and my thought process. I've experienced tremendous growth in every area of my life.
That's
right.
As I've committed to the Word, to reading and understanding the Word, and knowing the Lord and what He's doing through the Word, He's begun to correct so many things in my life. I'm so grateful for what the Lord has done. I'm so thankful for the things He's straightened out in my life, my relationships with Him, my confidence and my trust in Him, my marriage, my relationships with my children and my family, the work of the ministry. He's straightened out so much in my life. He's corrected a lot of things. And you know what? A lot of them weren't off, but with just simple adjustments and simple understanding, and He's corrected some things so that life is so much easier.
Come on, bro,
now.
Man, reach.
Life is so much easier now.
Yes, sir.
How I lead and represent myself in the workplace. He's corrected so much in my life, and He continues to do so. And I'm all right with that because I understand that He corrects me so that I can continue to grow.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Which takes us to the next thing. The Word of God instructs us in righteousness. Second Timothy says, The Word of God trains us in righteousness. Look at Psalms 119. Psalms 119. Psalms 119 and verse 130. There's a lot of verses in Psalms 119. Psalms 119 says this: the unfolding of your words gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. Another version says this: your word is a doorway that lets in light, and it helps gullible people understand. People often say to me, Brother Mario, you make the word sound so simple, and it's easy to understand. And do you know that that's something I specifically ask God for? In my everyday reading, when I'm studying, when I'm sharing the Word, I specifically ask the Lord for that thing, for my own learning and understanding. In the book of John, Jesus is speaking to the disciples who are questioning what He just finished sharing about Himself because they didn't understand something. I think it's John 60, 63. And He turned around and He said to them this: it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak are spirit and they are life. And we must approach the Lord and His word in that manner. We can't approach the word the way we would approach one another in the flesh. When we approach God, we have to approach Him in the spirit. I'm not making that clear. When I approach the Lord in His Word, I don't just want to memorize His Word. I want to learn something from His Word. I want to learn something. And I understand that this is the very essence of God. This is God, all God breathed. And I want to learn something from this. I want to know and understand the Spirit of God when I'm reading the Word. I want to understand and experience the life that is in His Word. He breathed this in this for a purpose. And I want to pull that out. I want that in my life. I want the spirit and life that is in His spoken word.
Amen.
In my life. And that's how we must approach the Word of God. And so when I approach the Word of God, I understand that if I open this book and I just start reading, a lot of it will not make sense to me. So when I approach the Word of God, and I ask the Lord, Lord, show me something. If it's just one scripture, that's enough. The thing about the Word and reading and understanding the Word, it's not about how many chapters you read. It's not about how many books you read. It's not how fast you can go to the Bible. It's what you can get from the Bible.
Yeah,
and sometimes for me, it's 5 minutes and I'm set for the day.
Yeah.
Sometimes I have to press in. And it's hours. Sometimes my wife has to come and say, "Babe, let's take a break. You need to eat something." But whatever it is, the understanding is that we're approaching the Word of God to get something from it. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Amen. I want to understand and experience the life that is in His Word. And I know I struggle. I know I fall short many times. However, when I'm before the Lord in prayer, or if it should ever be in person, I want the Lord to know that I have every desire to know and understand Him. When I'm in prayer, or when it comes to where I have to stand the Lord and give an account, I want the Lord to know that I wanted to know Him. I wanted to walk close with Him. I wanted to understand His precepts. I wanted to understand His Word. Right. I have every desire to live and walk right before Him in this life. So for what purpose of the Word? For what purpose is the Word working in our life? 2 Timothy, we're going to go back to it. Chapter 3, verse 17. I'll just read it. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. We talked about that. For reproof, rebuke, we talked about that. For correction, we talked about that. For instruction in righteousness, we talked about that. Here's the purpose for it. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Come on.
Now I want to talk about what that means, because understanding is key. What does it mean to be complete and thoroughly equipped for every good work? Well, I just mentioned something that Jesus said to His disciples who didn't understand. He said, "The words I speak are life, are spirit, and they are life." The Word of God will begin a spiritual work in us. For many of us, He's already, this is a group that I know that the Spirit of God has already begun working in our lives. The Word of God will begin a spiritual work in us. This is a spiritual blessing of grace. As we came to the Bible, we allow Him to speak to us. The spiritual work goes beyond our intellectual understanding. When we come to the Word, we begin to read, you may sometimes feel like you don't understand, but it's not a physical work that the Lord's doing in your life. It's a spiritual work. So you don't always have to understand it with your intellect. We read in our opening scripture that eternal life was brought to us through the Word. 1 Peter 1:23 also says, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible seed, through the Word of God, which lives and abides in us forever. We're talking now about the spiritual work that the Word of God does in our life. It corrects, it teaches us, it rebukes us, it corrects us, it instructs us in righteousness. The spiritual work begins to happen. Watch the spiritual work that happens. The Word, I mentioned this earlier, that the Word spiritually cleanses us. Ephesians 5:26. Says that He might sanctify and cleanse her, who? The church, that's us, with the washing of the Word, that He might present her to Himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she, us, the church, should be holy and without blemish. Let's keep on going on the spiritual work of the Word. The Word gives us power and weapons against the enemy. The Word gives us power and weapons against the enemy. Same book, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17. Says, and I take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And the context behind that, if you read the scripture, is talking about the weapons of our warfare being spiritual in nature. And the Word is one of our weapons. The Word is one of our weapons. The Word brings spiritual power to heal our bodies. Let's go to the Gospels and look at some of the Word, through the Word. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 5. Let me see here. I'm at the wrong place. Hold on 1 second. I'm going to find it right now. Where's Yvette? Help me out, Sister Yvette. No. Who's that? Is that Ernie?
Get out, say Jesus.
All right. Sorry, Ernie. Get it together right now, bro. All right, let's go. It's chapter 8, verse 5. My bad, Ernie. Chapter 8, verse 5. Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him pleading with him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I'll come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. Look at verse 13. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way, and as you have believed, so let it be done for you. And his servant was healed that same hour. We're talking about healing power in the word. Remember, Jesus said, the words I speak are spirit and they are life. Look at verse 16. Same chapter, verse 16. When evening had come, they brought him to who Jesus, they brought to Jesus many who were demon-possessed, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. The word brings spiritual power to heal our bodies. There is power in the word. Remember I said that the same authority and power that God spoke creation into existence is the same authority and power that is in the word. Amen. The word of God brings us spiritual life, our strength, spiritual strength for life. The word of God brings us spiritual strength for life. The psalmist said in Psalmist 119, same psalm, Psalmist 119, 25 through 28. My soul clings to the dust. Revive me according to your word. I have declared my ways, and you answered me. Teach me your statutes. Make me understand the way of your precepts. So I shall meditate on your wonderful works. My soul melts from heaviness. Strengthen me according to your word. The word of God will bring us spiritual strength for life. I'm going somewhere with all this, so stay with me. The word of God has power to spiritually build faith in us as a believer. You'll be very familiar with this next scripture, Romans 10:17. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith comes by hearing, and by hearing the word of God. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When I got a hold of this spiritual implication in Romans 10:17, when I got a hold of what it was saying, I began to let the word of God play around me, literally. I went out and purchased the Bible on CDs just so that I could play them in the background and hear it, because it was building my faith. I began to let worship and praise music play around me. I began to let solid sermons from the word play on around me, because it was building my faith. When I was in the battle, I let the power of the word through any of these avenues just play around me. Even in my sleep, because the word is spiritually directing faith toward me as I hear it.
That's right.
Faith is being added to my spirit, man. Faith is reviving my spirit, man, through the way of the word.
That's true.
Faith was igniting my spirit, man. And it was strengthening me to continue in this life. You understand what I'm saying to you? So when I got a hold of that, I went in, there was like the black case with all the Bible, all the books of the Bible, and I just played it in my car. It was boring. My wife was like, really, you're going to play that right now? Okay? When a long trip, you're going to play it? I used to just play it because I got a hold of that spiritual implication. Faith comes by hearing and by hearing the word of God. When I'm in the battle, I'll sleep. When I'm struggling, I'm battling from when I'm trying to get a hold of something, I just can't get it in the spirit. When I sleep, I'll just put my phone by my ear and I'll just let it play worship music too. I'll go to sleep. I'll just go to sleep. But faith is being added. Yeah, faith is being directed toward me. It's strengthening me.
Yeah.
And the word of God will provide spiritual strength for everything that we need in this life. See, because the word of God operates on a spiritual level, we don't always have to understand with our intellect to have the word effectively working in our lives. And many get discouraged because they don't feel like they get much when they read the Bible on their own. And so they give up. They give up reading. They don't read like they should. But we have to remember that we have to work or eagerly study to understand the word. Just do the best you can. We have to read the word thoroughly and carefully because it benefits us spiritually. And even when we don't understand it with our intellect, even when we feel like we had a whole session of a chapter and we just, what do I get from that? Something's happening. You see, over the years, I suppose I've gone to church more than 1,000 times easily. And I can't remember the specific content of many sermons over that time, with the exception of the one that just happened last week. However, they've nourished me along the way.
Yeah, sure.
Mm-hmm. And without them, I would be a very different man today.
Tell the truth, brother.
I can't remember the context behind all the sermons, all the thousands of sermons I've heard in church, as I visit other churches at home, what I've seen on TV, where I've listened on the tape or a CD that somebody's given me. I don't remember the context to all that. But it doesn't mean that it hasn't taken its work in my life. It doesn't mean that it hasn't built faith. It doesn't mean that it hasn't taken its effect. It's created me, and I would be a very different man without them. Amen?
Amen.
So the word will do a spiritual work in us if we allow it. And it brings me back to the purpose of the working of the word in our lives. 2 Timothy 3:17, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. I'm going to give it the best attempt to connect what I believe this means in relation to the working of the word in the life, in our life as believers. In the book of John, Big John, there's an account of Jesus praying for the disciples after walking with them in the ministry for 3 years. He's about to go to the cross. And begins to pray. And first he prays for himself, and then he prays for the disciples. But not only for the disciples, then he prays for us.
Yeah.
And we'll pick it up. We'll pick up the prayer in verse in John chapter 17, verse 6. When he starts praying for the disciples. John 17, verse 6. Hopefully I got this one right, Ernie. We're going to do some reading, okay? But listen to what it's saying. Listen to what it's saying. Listen to everything that I just shared, that we just learned. And listen to what Jesus is praying here. This is after he's walked for 3 years with the disciples, and he's about to go to the cross.
What's the difference?
You there? All right. I have manifested your name. He's praying to the Father. I have manifested your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me. And they have kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given to them the words which you have given me. And they have received them. And have known surely that I come forth from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you've given me. For they are yours. And all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now I'm no longer in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to you, Holy Father. Keep through your name those who you have given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was in them, in the world, I kept them in your name. Those to whom you gave me, I have kept. And none of them is lost except the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. He's talking about Judas. But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also send them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by truth. That was a prayer for the disciples. I do not pray for these alone. He begins to pray for us. Watch. But also for those who will believe me through their word. That they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. That they also may be one with us, or in us. That the world may believe that you sent me. And the glory which you gave me I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one. And that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you gave me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which you have given me. For you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you. And these have known that you sent me. And I have declared to them your name and will declare it, that the love which you love me may be in them and I in them.
Hallelujah.
It's talking about the word. It's talking about the word that the man of God, at the end of those 3 years, it was the word. It was the word that equipped the disciples for every good work that they were about to enter into. Here we have the disciples that have been walking alongside for 3 years, alongside with the Lord for 3 years, speaking the very word of the Father into their lives. Jesus was speaking the very word of the Father for 3 years. Were they perfect men? Did they have it all together? I think not. And Jesus is praying for them before he goes to the cross. And he's sending these out with a great commission to reach the world for Christ. He's sending them out to reach the world through the words that he spoke to them. And if you can think back, think about all of the emotions that must have been running through the disciples' minds or through the disciples' period as they saw Christ crucified. Think about what ran through their minds when the word of God came to recollection as they were going from town to town preaching the good news like they were commissioned to do. Through all the highs and through all the lows, the word makes the man of God complete and thoroughly equipped for every good work. And just like Jesus did with the disciples as he walked for them through tears and spoke the word of God until I spoke the word of God until I spoke the word of God, thoroughly equipping them for the work that was before them. That is the work of the word of God in our lives.
Amen.
It hits the believer, and it thoroughly equips us for the work that is set before us. It thoroughly equips us for every good work. We need to get in the Word. It's very important that we begin to get in the Word. We don't always have to understand it intellectually. The Word still has a spiritual working. It still has a spiritual working.
Amen, brother.
Amen? Yes, let's give God praise.
Amen.
It's probably not the popular teaching, but we need it.
Yeah.
This is essential for the life of the believer.
Yeah.
It's essential for the life of the believer. Amen?
Amen?
Let's close in prayer. Any prayer requests? Any prayer requests?
Trying to get my life ready. Trying to get back on track.
Josh wants to get back on track. Boom. What's going to do it? What's going to do it? The Word. The Word. It corrects us. The Word corrects us. And that's not a shame process, son. That's a process of love. That's a process of love. Amen. Yes, sir.
Job.
Let me get a job. Okay. Amen.
Rod and I are kind of fighting on wanting to buy my grandmother's house. So we need people to sign an agreement with us.
Okay.